In October 1991, a New England fishing boat by the name of the Andrea Gale sailed 500 miles into the Atlantic Ocean in search of what they hoped would be the catch to save their livelihood. But the weather was changing rapidly. A cold front moving along the western border sent a strong disturbance across New England, whilst at the same time a large high-pressure system was building, flowing from the north. Now, these circumstances alone could have created a strong storm, known locally as the Halloween Nor'easter. But, like throwing petrol on a fire, a hurricane coming in from the Atlantic brought unimaginable tropical storms. The crew of the Andrea Gale sailed that day into the perfect storm, and sadly, the boat and all its crew were lost. Now, you might be saying, what has this to do with Palm Sunday? I would like to suggest that as Jesus rode into Jerusalem on that first Palm Sunday, he rode into the perfect storm. But what forces combined to create such a storm? Now, the first two elements of Jesus' perfect storm are relatively easy to describe. The third, less so, but it's essential to consider if we are to understand both the original context of Palm Sunday and its relevance to us in the 21st century, as we, once again, begin our journey through Holy Week to the cross. So let's begin with the cold front sweeping in from the west. Rome. Rome, the ruling reality of the day, the superpower of the then known world. Now, 30 years before Jesus' birth, Rome had been a republic, but then came Julius Caesar. His ambition and his assassination threw Rome into a very long and bloody civil war, from which Caesar's adopted son, Octavian, emerged as the victor. Now, he immediately changed his name to Augustus, which means majestic or worthy of honour, a tad egocentric, I might like to suggest. Now, not only did he do that, he then declared his father Julius as divine, and this means that he was now officially the son of God. And very quickly, around the then known world, which Rome was quickly conquering, these words were repeated. Good news! We have an emperor! The Son of God has become king of the world. Now, after Augustus died, Tiberius took the same titles. So the language that the Roman emperor was the Son of God and king of the world was part of the everyday life of the culture Jesus lived in. So you imagine the impact of Jesus riding into Jerusalem, packed full of visitors for the greatest Jewish celebration of the year, people proclaiming him to be king of the Jews, shouting words of praise and worship, declaring he was the Son of God. Now, the job of a Roman governor was to administer justice, collect taxes, and keep the peace, and particularly to suppress unrest. Now, that was a very difficult task in a region as unstable as Palestine. In Roman eyes, as Jesus rode into Jerusalem, Jesus was claiming the title of the emperor, king of the Jews, and son of God. This was treason, and crucifixion was guaranteed. The first element of our perfect storm. So what's the second element in Jesus' perfect storm? Israel. Israel, well described as the overheated high-pressure system. Now, Israel's narrative throughout the generations is one of purpose, a purpose given by God. And this narration, this story of purpose and calling by God was kept alive throughout each generation. And each generation was waiting for God to fulfil his promises to them. Now, at the centre of this narrative, at the centre of this story, is the story of the Exodus. Moses leading the Israelites out of slavery across the Red Sea, through the desert to the Promised Land. And the Jews lived on the hope that this would happen again. Oppressors could come and go, they could do their worst, but God would deliver them and they would be victorious. And so at Passover, this great national festival, Jesus makes his crucial move. The history of Israel collides with the history of Rome. This is no time to be out on the sea in an open boat, nor riding into Jerusalem on a donkey. The western wind of Rome meets the high-pressure system of Judaism. But what about the hurricane? You know, there's always been a very unpredictable and element in the Jewish story, and that is Yahweh. And as Isaiah wrote, God's thoughts are not our thoughts, nor his ways our ways. Repeatedly, Israel's narrative about its own journey, its own purpose, have been very different from the plans and the purposes and the narrative of God. And Jesus was the personification of that conflict. God's thoughts versus Israel's thoughts. Yes, God had promised to come back to his people in power and glory, and that his kingdom will come to earth as it was in heaven. Now, the Jewish interpretation of that was that God would underwrite their national aspirations. He was, after all, their God. He was their God. But time and time again, the prophets, including John the Baptist, had warned them if their aspirations didn't match God's, then they too would be judged. Now, coupled with this, they appeared to have conveniently forgotten that their God had called them to be a blessing to the nations. Now, when Jesus entered Jerusalem, he was embodying, incarnating the return of Israel's God to his people in power and in glory. But it was a different kind of power. It was a different kind of glory. Throughout his public ministry, Jesus had been the incarnation of the rescuing, redeeming love of Israel's God. But his people had refused to see it. So Jesus, the divine hurricane, sweeps in, seizing the moment of Passover, of Exodus. These two events in history that speak of God's sovereign freedom and presence amongst his people. And the perfect storm breaks in the shape of a cross. Jesus said, "Take up your cross and follow me." And as we do, we can often find ourselves caught up in our own versions of a perfect storm. Firstly, the pressure to conform to the culture around us presses in. The drip, drip, drip of secularism, telling us that the church is irrelevant and that anyway, faith's a private affair. Secondly, the pressure from our own aspirations and expectations. We have dreams, we have visions. We may want to graduate, get a job or promotion, earn some money, earn more money, get married, have children, live a long and healthy life, and the list can go on. Now, none of these aspirations, of course, are wrong in and of themselves, but when was the last time you or we stopped and asked the question, does our aspirations, do our expectations, do our visions and dreams match God's aspirations and purposes for our lives? Is there more to life than this? So as we approach Good Friday, we should be aware and praying for the third element in our storm to manifest, and that's God. You know, God is not here to merely back up our own ambitions and aspirations, nor will God simply fit into the spirit of this age? These two weather fronts we are exposed to all the time. But during Holy Week, we are called to open ourselves up to the third element in the storms of life, God. I'd like to quote to you from N.T. Wright, and he says these words, which I think are really inspiring. If we try to follow Jesus in faith and hope and love on his journey to the cross, we will find that the hurricane of love, which we tremblingly call God, will sweep in from a fresh angle, fulfilling our dreams by first shattering them, bringing something new out of the dangerous combination of personal hopes and cultural pressures. We mustn't be surprised if in this process there are moments when it feels as though we are being sucked down to the depths, 500 miles from shore, amid 100-foot waves, weeping for the dream that has to die, for the kingdom that isn't coming the way we wanted. This is what it's like when we are caught up in Jesus' perfect storm. But be sure, when that happens, when you say with the disciples on the road to Emmaus, we had hoped, but now it's all gone, that you are on the verge of hearing the fresh word, the word that comes when the storm is stilled. And in the new great calm, we see a way forward we had never imagined. Foolish ones, says Jesus, and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets had spoken. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and so enter into his glory? Wonderful, stirring words. Who knows what might happen if each of us were to approach Holy Week and Good Friday, praying humbly for the powerful, fresh wind of the Holy Spirit upon our lives, to open ourselves afresh to the new life that he longs to give us. May the Holy Spirit push aside the combination of cultural and personal pressures that so often bear down upon us, that we might understand anew the sufferings of our Lord and be truly transformed. In a year where we have known such national and international suffering, such an unprecedented, unexpected perfect storm, more than ever our world needs Christians full of the Holy Spirit and full of hope to be able to say there is more to life than this, and that his name is Jesus. May the perfect storms that sweep into our lives and the perfect storm that has swept into our world break into the shape of the cross. Come, Lord Jesus, come. Amen.